So good morning, everyone. So I'm Laurence Ramos, working in CNRS in Montpellier, and I'm a soft matter scientist, experimentalist, and I started working on, let's say, food-related materials a few years ago. I wanted first to thank the organizer for this setting up this nice meeting and giving me the opportunity to present this work. And this work is about gluten, and I'll try to show you how we can get very useful information by combining science and science. And I will show you pieces of work of a bunch of students and postdocs, Mohsen Baej, Justine Pasmay, Salvatore Consenso, Amar Luishi. And all this work has been done with my two close collaborators, Marie-Hélène Morel and Amélie Ban. So what is gluten? So gluten is the protein that we get, the storage protein that we get from in the wheat grains. So you probably all know gluten, either because you want to avoid it for health issue, or because you want to take advantage of their very unique properties, like being a very viscoelastic network that is really an added value if you want to make bread or a croissant in a very efficient manner. And it's also a very fascinating material for a scientist, because there's still a lot, it's unique in the plant world, this kind of viscoelastic network, and there's still a lot of questions regarding the relationship between the structure of these materials and their mechanical properties, both in the linear regime and especially in the non-linear regime. So a fascinating subject, but very complicated. And it's very complicated because it's a huge mixture of several proteins, more than 60 types of polypeptides, and which can be classified, let me put my pointer, can be classified into two main families, gliadin, which are essentially monomeric protein, and glutenins, which are units, which are linked together by disulfide bond, and you can reach very, very long polymer up to 7 million grams per mole. And you see here this domain in blue. Actually, they are intrinsically disordered domains made of repetitive units, and they provide a lot of flexibility to these proteins, which in fact behaves more like polymer than like colloids. And on top of that, these gluten are insoluble in water, and you can see it here in these two images. So here you just have a gluten when you add a little bit of water, so you get this very viscoelastic mass. But if you add more water, you have a phase separation, you cannot swell this network. So which this kind of material are not easy, let's say, to make rationalized studies, because you basically you're stuck with one concentration. So to overcome this limitation, we choose to work on a more model-like system using a good solvent for this protein, which is a mixture of water and ethanol. So the extraction procedure we have developed is based on gluten, this industrial gluten that we first dissolve in these water ethanol mixtures, and we just keep the soluble part, because there is one part where the polymers are so long that they're not soluble in any solvent. So we keep this soluble part, and then we take advantage of this liquid-liquid phase separation that you could have when you quench the sample. And what we found is that depending on the quench temperature, you can actually control and tune the composition of your protein extract, and you can vary the glutenin content of your protein extract from virtually zero up to something like 70%. And what you see in this kind of images here is that with this model protein extract, you can get nice and homogeneous samples over a very broad range of concentration, for very dilute, here it's 10 milligram per ml, till a very concentrated system. And you got from liquid-like samples up to gels. So you have homogeneous samples, which are, let's say, more convenient to investigate experimentally. So the first thing we did was to look at what we have in a very dilute regime. So we use asymmetrical flow field flow fractionation in combination with multi-angle static and dynamic light scattering. And we found that we have different three families of species in our materials. We have what we expect because we put monomers, which are in fact the gliadins, so small molecules of a few nanometer size. We have also the glutenin, the polymer that we put inside, which we show behave as polymer chain in good solvent condition and with intermediate molecular weight and a few tenths of nanometer size. And what was interesting to us also is that we have a third families of species, which are assemblies. So they are big objects of about 100 nanometer in size, and they have a very large molecular weight, something like 30 million, so much larger than all the species we put in our solution. And we can show that they are made of, they have a polymeric branch and loose structure. So in fact, they are assemblies of different kinds of proteins. And what was interesting is that if you look at these assemblies, the amount of assemblies is correlated with the amount of glutenin we have in the sample. So we are really interested in these assemblies. And we were first asking whether we could have some hint of the presence of these assemblies if we go to more concentrated samples now. So this is just a schematic and very rapid conclusion. So this is a phase diagram. So we have a one phase at high temperature and then a two phase version when we quench a sample. And if we quench to an intermediate temperature, what we see with light microscopy is this development and coarsening of structure, which are in fact spinodal decomposition. And using USAX, ultra-small angle X-ray scattering performed at ESRF in Grenoble in France, and a time result, we can really follow the characteristic size of this structure as it develops with time and show that it really behaves as standard spinodal decomposition. We also found, for instance, that if we use a sample which a larger quantity of gluten in some more viscoelastic sample, we can have also small anomalous spinodal decomposition. But I don't have time, unfortunately, to talk more about that. What I just wanted to say here is that if we quench further the system and not speaking about quenching deeper, what we see that the droplet that forms here, you have another phase separation inside, and which is due to the hidden phase diagram of gliadin that we have at lower temperature. So all this to say that the fact that we have this multiple liquid-liquid phase separation is a hint that we also have the presence of this big object assembly that first separate at relatively low temperature. So the question is, do we see more directly these assemblies in this kind of samples? So the first thing we did was to look at the scattering. So here you have a curve of the scattering profile in scattering intensity as a function of the wave vector. And we combine different techniques, wax, SACS, and very small angle neutron scattering this time to cover a very broad range of concentration. And what we see, in fact, and I'm going to detail a little bit this curve, is that we have different features with all lead us to the conclusion that it's really the scattering of a polymeric network in good solvent condition with some large land scale heterogeneities cropped here. So what we see is that at large Q, so small descent, we have the rod-like structure of individual protein, and then we have up to the Q which correspond to the persistent length, and then we have the random walk of this protein, of this rod-like molecules, which is exactly what we observe with this -5 third power law, which is what you expect and predict for a polymer in good solvent condition, until you have the crossover when you reach a semi-dilute regime and you get the correlation length or block size. And then at smaller Q, you have this power law decrease with the exponent of -2, which show you that you have fractal organization at very large length scale and heterogeneity at this length scale. But we don't have any clear signature of these assemblies up to the moment. And the the surprise went when we did small angle neutron scattering. So for scattering, whatever it is, neutron or X-ray, you expect the scatter intensity to be proportional to the form factor, the scattering factor, and times this factor, which is delta rho square, which is the contrast between the scattering object in a solvent. So usually, and it's a standard way to avoid incoherent scattering, you replace in your sample when you do neutron, you replace your hydrogenated solvent by your deuterated solvent. And therefore, what you expect, you just change the contrast. So instead of having this contrast of your, let's say, your polymer gel in hydrogenated solvent, you will get this contrast. But basically, you expect the same scattering profile with simply different intensity because you have different contrast. And what we observe is totally different. So here in light blue, you see what we have observed, what I showed you before, where you have this fractile-like evolution at very low Q, so at large length scale. And here we recover the polymeric-like structure we have at large Q, so small length scales. But when we do this neutron scattering, what we find is that also at small length scale, we still have the signature of our polymer in good solvent condition. We have a totally different system here with this Q minus 4 dependent and this roll-off at small Q. And of course, you could say, okay, you change H by D, so you might change the interaction if your material, but not at all. In fact, if you look, we did also using the dissolvent in sacks. So this, we got the same system. If you do SAMS with the H solvent, you got this. So it's only when you have when you do neutron scattering with a deuterated solvent that you have this totally different scattering profile. So what do you see? If you do neutron scattering, basically with deuterated solvent, you see the contrast between H and D. And of course, and we have talked yesterday on this, you have some H and D exchange when you use the deuterated solvent, because we use this mixture of water ethanol with the D instead of H, and you have this D deuterium from D2O and the one OD here, which are labile, and we can exchange with some of the H that you have on the proteins, and which are the one which are linked to this S, N, or O atoms. So you have this exchange. But if you have the exchange, you go from this situation to this situation when you reduce the contrast, but still you get the same contrast if you assume you have an homogeneous exchange. So the only way the only hypothesis we have to explain our data is that in fact we don't have an homogeneous exchange, but we have a very inhomogeneous exchange, implying that in some part of the in some domains in our material we don't have this HD exchange, and basically we have here a domain which is enriched in H in a sea of enriched in D solvent, and we see this contrast when we do a small angle neutron scattering. So what, in a more physical point of view, well, first you can, of course, extract the characteristic size of this domain. So we use a standard model which have been built up to model microphase separation solid system. This is the bulbrush model, which is nothing else than implying that you have sharp interfaces between two domains. So you have this Q minus 4 and you have a cutoff at a given wave vector, it gives you the size of this domain. So you have here the fit of this with this model, and from that you can extract the characteristic size of this domain, which is of the order of 60 nanometers. So on a more physical point of view, what happens is that in this domain you don't have H and D exchange, and you don't have this because we believe we have a very strong H bond interaction between the proteins, which prevent this exchange. So to prove that, and we believe that this domain, in fact, has really as the signature of the protein assemblies that we have in the dilute regime. And why do we believe so? First, we believe so because we think we measure that this characteristic size is independent of the protein concentration of our sample, independent of the fact that of the composition we use to make this data. So as we have observed for these assemblies in the dilute regime, they have more or less the same size of the protein assembly we measure in the dilute regime. And if we look quantitatively and quantify, because we have the same size, basically the intensity you have at low Q is directly proportional to the amount of these domains. And if you plot this intensity at small Q as a function of what you expect for the assemblies that you have measured the dilute regime, we have a super nice correlation, which in fact implies that the two are correlated. And what we see here in this domain, which are held by edge bond, is really the signature of the protein assembly that we are able to highlight thanks to this contrast variation technique. So just one or two slides to finish. So just to make the correlation with the mechanical property, here are the frequency sweep of the elastic modulus G prime and the loss modulus G double prime as a function of a frequency for different samples with rather concentrated, but with different quantity of glutenin for the protein extract. And we go from liquid-like samples when we have essentially a system very poor in glutenin up to gel when we have a sample enriched in this glutenin. And if we have this sample, so I recall you that this is this kind of sample where we have these assemblies in dilute regime and the heterogeneous deterioration in semi-dilute regime that we have interpreted as being due to this strong edge bond between the proteins. And in fact, if you take, if you take this gel and dilute it in a mixture of water, ethanol, and urea is a compound that just disrupts all edge bond in the material. And what you see that if you dilute your sample in this urea-based material, you dissolve your gel, while you don't do it if you just use a simple water ethanol. So it's another evidence that edge bond is also important to control the gelation property of this network. So to conclude, I hope I convinced you that both edge bonds are very important to control the gelation of this material, and also that they are the main interaction that keep the proteins together, and they are both in the dilute regime and concentrated regime. And something I wanted to stress here in this audience is that thanks to a combination of SACs and contrast variation, we are able to get unique information and indirectly visualize and have a clear signature of these protein assemblies in a concentrated regime. And with that, I thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Laurence. I don't know if there's any questions for you, so I'm just going to ask you one just to start. How do you know that you have these inhomogeneities when you're doing the exchange?
I'm stuck. I cannot change my slides. Actually, it took us a long time. I mean, that was this experiment that you. I don't know if you see my pointer. Probably not.
No.
Okay. Here. When we did this experiment, we were expecting to get the same results in SANS, and actually, we just did SANS because we wanted to extend the web vector that we could access, and it was easier at that time to do SANS and SACs. And then we got these totally different results.
So you had to explain them, and then you're starting to
have to explain. So we did a lot of contrast variation to change the contrast from pure D solvent to pure F solvent. And yeah, we have to explain, and that was the only explanation. I think it's reasonable, but maybe someone we came up with another explanation.
Well,
but it's different.
Maybe this follows Tommy's question that he just put in the chat, and he says, how does the size of the aggregate vary with the preparation? And if you have these domains, can you change the size of the domains somehow?
No. Well, for the moment, no. The way we prepare the sample is that we have this, we have this sample preparation with, we have this liquid-liquid phase separation, then we freeze dry the samples, and then we hydrate them again. And once we do that, we always get, here I don't show the size, but basically whatever the composition we have, we always get the same size. And this is a size you observe also systematically when we do science experiments. The question we had, actually the biochemist we're working with us, is whether this freeze drying procedure also change something in the assemblies, and we have some hint that it might change a little bit the size of this zone, but it's something we haven't explored that much for the moment.
Yeah, actually, I have a similar idea about how we rehydrate powders, and is it really what we see part of the fact that we cannot rehydrate fully, and in some places you cannot exchange with deuterated water. So it's probably kind of a similar.
Interesting.
Okay, so if nobody else has any questions, it's coffee time.